Namaste and good afternoon. I, Tanusha Bansal.
I, Sonali Sharma.
Welcome you all to the Swachhta Jagran Samiti live stream interview with Mr. Colonel Mohinder Pal Singh. Colonel Mohinder Pal Singh was commissioned in the 3 Maha Regiment in December 1989. He is a graduate in science from prestigious St. Xavier's College, Mumbai, a gold medalist in MSc in Defence and Strategic Studies from University of Delhi, a MBA in International Trade from IIFT, New Delhi. He has done his PhD in the field of International Relations from University of Allahabad. In his army career of 30 years, he has participated in various combat operations with his battalion and with Rashtriya Rifles Battalion. He has qualified the most difficult training courses of the Indian Army, the Commando course from Infantry School Belgaum and Winter Warfare course at High Altitude Warfare School Gulmarg. He has been GTO at 19 SSB Allahabad for 3 years and senior GTO at 14 SSB for about 3 years. During his SSB tenure, he has assessed over 13,000 candidates in stage 1 and over 3,000 candidates in stage 2 for the post of officers. Other than this, he has been an instructor in military tactics wing in Infantry School Belgaum and served as research officer in College of Defense Management in his recipient of Chief of Army Staff Commendation for his commendable work during the service. Apart from above services, he has published many self-help books on team building and success mantras, which are widely read by the youth. He has also published over 40 articles in various journals and newspapers like Times of India, Financial Express, The Tribune, and many on issues related to defense forces and national security. Colonel Mohinder took voluntary retirement in June 2018. He is presently founder and director of a startup, Academy of Military Aptitude and Skill, AMAS Training at Greater Noida, where he passionately mentors SSB aspirants or defense service aspirants from across the India. From 1993 students trained at AMAS, 113 students of AMAS have cracked SSB and joined academies for military training as officers.
It's really inspiring to hear about his journey and the fact that he continues to serve the country after his retirement by training youth. So before we start, let me brief about the Swachhta Jagran Samiti. The Swachhta Jagran Samiti is headed by A.K. Chaudhary as the president, Meena Chaudhary as the chairperson, and the Harshita Solanki as the managing director. It is a registered non-profit organization based in Gurgaon at Delhi. Swachhta Jagran Samiti, as its name implies, it has two dimensions, cleanliness and awakening. First, preserve ecosystem and support sustainable development action. Secondly, spread awareness and awake the nation. Therefore, we believe that the aim of this interaction session is to learn from the vast experience and achievements of Colonel Mohinder Pal Singh, not only in the career, but also about life.
Thank you.
I request all the participants and all the audience to put their questions in the comment box or in the WhatsApp group.
So we'll be coming in a moment.
So let's begin. With much honor, let's welcome Colonel Mohinder Pal Singh. It's a great pleasure for us to host you, sir. With your due permission, I request Sunali to begin the session.
Thank you, Tanisha. Jai Hind, sir. It's really a great honor to me to get this opportunity. So, sir, my first question to you is that after serving almost 30 years in the military, you have experienced a lot of challenges. What was the most challenging part of being in the military and how did you overcome it?
Well, firstly, thank you very much for inviting me here to your studios. And it's a great pleasure to speak to not only our audience, but I would say to the countrymen. Armed Forces, I served for 30 years and I really, really, firstly tell me, am I audible and clear? And actually speaking, I have not seen any other life. And I feel if I am born again, I should again serve in the same life which I have served in this life. So that has been my experience. Now, if you talk of challenges, yes, it is a job which is full of challenges and full of adventure and full of experiences. But as an officer of the Defense Forces, the challenges range from being a leader or leading the men, and the challenges are serving the nation in various capacities, in various locations, in various trying circumstances. So maybe in a further part of the interview, I'll elaborate what I mean by serving in extreme areas and in operations and other things. But overall, this journey of 30 years, which began with a college boy, just out of the college and into the training academy. It finished in 2018. And after that also, I am in touch with the Defense Forces because now I am full-time kind of involved in mentoring the young aspirants and preparing them for a career as officers. So I am still in touch with my Defense Forces, with the kind of people I served with. And this journey of 30 years has been a memorable one, yeah.
Thank you, sir. Sir, so my next question, could you please tell me what made you join the army? Did you have any expectations from your journey? How would you describe it?
See, what made me join the army, now you have gone through my CV. I was studying in Bombay, and I'm a son of an army officer, and my father was posted in a difficult area, so I was not staying with him that time. I was at Bombay and studying in St. Xavier's College, and there are all these companies. They used to come for taking campus placements, and one of these companies came in, and I was in my final year, and all these options were open in front of me. It was not that I had pre-decided that I would be just joining the Defence Forces, but no, it was one of my main options at all the time. But yes, other options are also open. So these companies came in, and I sat for like any other young children like you sit for campus placement. So I also sat for it, and about 300 odd students were there, and they kept shortlisting after every stage, and after fourth, fifth stage. We went to the last 10, and they called us to some five-star hotel in Mumbai, and then they said, okay, some series of last interviews. And finally, I think what I remember out of the 300, about eight, nine of us were picked up as management trainees. So now at the same time, around the same time, 15 days here there, I was also through with my interview for as an army officer to join the Armed Forces as direct entry for Indian Military Academy. So now the dilemma came, and you know what, at that time, one always looks at the salary and perks and all. So both were offering almost the same perks, right? The army salary and the salary as a management trainee was the same. And on one side, this was a management trainee in the five-star chain of hotels, very glamorous, right? And then when I went for the interview, oh, I never been to a five-star hotel before, and it was so glamorous. So the dilemma was there. In spite of being from an army family, so I wrote to my father. I said, look, I've got this campus placement, and I've got this through with the written and interview also. So what should be I do? I mean, the both are, as far as I am concerned, both are equal. But my narrow vision that time, which made me think both are equal, was not the same what echoed from my father's return reply. And the return reply was, well, they are certainly not equal. In the hotel industry, which you intend joining, you will be serving the rich. And if you join the armed forces, you'll be serving the nation. And this tagline, once it came, I think I had no dilemma left in my mind. And 1 month after that, I was wearing the uniform at Indian Military Academy, Dehradun. So that was how I joined. That was the change, right? So predestined to join the Defence Forces to serve the nation. Wherever when you take the oath as an officer, you take the oath that wherever the country sends me, whether it is in air or water or soil or mountain, anywhere I go, I will serve the nation. So that is the oath you take as an officer, and that's the oath you live by when you serve the forces.
It was so inspiring to hear, and that tagline also will inspire us so much. Thank you so much, sir. So now I am curious about how you experienced the winter welfare courses and the commando courses as some of the hardest courses. What was your experience like, and how did you this courses challenge you?
So you see, I got commissioned in infantry, and infantry is the main battle arm of the Defence Forces. So when you are in the infantry, you have to qualify on such courses which toughen you up, and they teach you specialized techniques of warfare. So commando is the first course which every young officer, after he does his preliminary courses called a young officer's course, and the next course you have to do it is commando course. So our time commando course was 32 days of really, really difficult physical activities. The classes range from morning 3 o'clock. It starts at morning 3 o'clock, and generally they end by night 11 o'clock. This is the daily routine. So average sleep of this course, we calculated was about 3.5 hours, or less than 3, about 3 hours was the average sleep over 30 days, right? So it is quite toughening on your body, but well, you get attuned to it so much that at the end of it, you feel that yes, you see, the body which we have made of can take on so much if you put it through a difficult time. Now, it was very challenging for two, three things, and I'll just narrate these two, three incidents which really, I would say at that time I was very scared, but I could overcome that feeling. Dar ke aage jeet hai. So the first one was that jump, which you have to jump into a swimming pool from 60 feet, something is called the Lido jump, confidence jump or Lido jump. So I was a non-swimmer before I joined IMA. I just managed to learn a little bit of swimming, and I not jumped, from high this thing and all. So when this turn came, so I told my instructor, we call them Ustad, I'm not a swimmer. So you want me to jump from the 60 feet into the swimming pool, right? And you have to hang with the rope and then you have to leave the rope, 60 feet. So he gave me two quick, what do you call, cheat codes. So he said, firstly, you do one thing, since you are so scared and you're first time going at that height and then you're hanging in air and then you have to leave your hand and jump into the pool, it'll take about, you'll come at a speed of gravity, 9.8 meter per second square, right? So it will take 60 feet will take, I think, about 3-4 seconds, right? For you to touch the water. So I said, of course. He said, what you do is, you when you are hanging there, you will be above the trees. So close your eyes. That will help you overcome that fear. Because if you find yourself hanging so high, and when you look down at the swimming pool, it looks so small, you are going to get scared. And first time. So I said, fine. I said, okay. So when I reached out there, first time I was hanging there and had to shout. Commando MP saying ready for jump, sir, and the shout should show your confidence. Okay, so I did that because when you are together, when you're doing it in together, your course mates are watching you, and everybody is all eyes on you and focus. So I just I got I was it was a big challenge for me. I just the moment they fired that bullet, you have to listen to the bullet and leave your hand. I just came down. The first jump was not that good because they want you to come down absolutely straight body and don't look down, because when you look down, your body gets tilted. So that was it. Now, second jump after 2 days was more scary. Somebody would think, why it is more scary? Because you already had experience. Yeah, it was more scary because I knew that how scary it was in the first jump, right? So the second jump was more scary, but I did it better. I followed the instructions and I did it better. So this was one of the experiences which every one of us has. And of course, the second experience was there was a you have to do jungle navigation, and where two it is in buddy pairs, two pairs, and where they leave you at the evening 6 o'clock, and there's a big jungle, and you have to navigate yourself and reach another place about 30-35 kilometers. And that was quite a bit because we were taught the navigation by stars. Stars also indicate directions. So we were taught navigation by stars. Now, we fix the stars in which direction we have to move. You don't have any map, no compass, nothing. You have to navigate with stars and some other landmarks, right? So we both left at 6 p.m. and whole night you have to navigate and reach the destination before 7 a.m. And if you don't reach there, then you are considered as fail on the test of navigation. So you know what happened? We started moving, and around 11:30, I think we were in the right direction, only two of us. So they're two pairs. So they are spread out around, I think, 50 kilometers and 50 to 70, 50 kilometers by jungle area. So at around 11:30, we suddenly found a thin layer of cloud coming. Now that's literally scared us, because thin layer of cloud meant the stars are gone. So the moment the stars are gone, how do you navigate? So now we said, oh my God, now you have to move on your instinct, right? So we kept moving. I think we lost a little bit of direction, and because of that, we had to walk more, about 6-7 kilometers, because we lost our way, and then we reached a little wrong place. But by the time we corrected it, we were just in time. The closing gate was 7 o'clock, and I think we were at 6:45. We managed to reach there in spite of all the delays. So that was two, memorable incidents of my journey at Commando course. And coming to the winter warfare, yeah, winter warfare is a course where they train you to sustain in altitudes at around 14,000 feet, up to 14,500 feet they take you. So we had a camp at around 14,000 feet, and the most interesting part was you sleep in two officers in one tent, and you have to lie down and enter the tent because it's called a pop tent. And there we used to sleep, and you would lie down, enter inside in lying position, and then enter your sleeping bags. and things like that. And the breakfast would get a piece of bread and jam and all that, and the moment and the hot cup of tea. And the snow where we were camping was about 30 feet. Our camp was on 30 feet of snow. And the temperature was almost minus 10, minus 12 degrees. That is the winter warfare. And every day we had to go skiing with our haversacks and our weapons. And every day skiing was about 10 to 12 kilometers, called alpine skiing. This is called alpine skiing. You ski through these pine forest trees. And you know, the breakfast time when they used to heat the bread and give you, while we were eating, the bread would get frozen in our hands because you are in tents and in the open. There are no huts or no buildings. The complete camp is in tents. So while you are eating the bread, so the temperature is minus 10 degrees, the bread will become like solid rock. And then you have to dip it in the tea, in the hot tea, then it becomes a little soft. And the second thing was happening when we were coming down on the last day. You come down with complete your gear, that is your haversacks, which is about 8 to 10 kgs and a weapon. So when you're skiing down, so this accident took place where my buddy was there, another officer. He, while turning the ski, turns are very difficult. Very difficult. If you slow down or if you have a slight bit of speed, you are likely to topple over. And it straight away hits your ankle. The ankles are gone because the skis are attached with they're detachable skis. They're supposed to auto-detach if you fall. And we had the best of the skis. The army always gave you the best of the equipment. But still, the thing is that it is accident-prone, right? So, while both of us were coming down, we were coming down at a reasonable speed, not too much speed, but during one turn, my buddy, who was another young lieutenant, he got disbalanced and he toppled over. And the ski got off, but his ankle got badly, badly damaged. Now, in the heat of everybody coming in, we are all skiing down one after the other, like a swarm, like almost about 100 of us. Now, people didn't realize that what has happened. So we stopped on a side, and I did not realize the damage to my buddy. So when everybody had almost passed, I said, sir, he was a little senior to me. I said, sir, have a look. I mean, can you walk? Should I put your ski back? Because you are expected to help your buddy. You are in buddy pairs. So when he realized, he said, MP, I think my ankle is gone. So I don't think I can now do skiing. It is paining so badly that I can't put the ski back. So then what choice I had? I looked back, I looked around, there was nobody. Everybody had skied down. I knew they would come to rescue us once they reached down, which is about half an hour of skiing, about 2 kilometers down. And when they realize these two guys are missing, then the search party would come. And this was in Gulmarg. Winter Warfare School is in Gulmarg. And this incident took place at a height above Gulmarg called Killanmarg. Even above that, it's about 14,000 feet. So I said, okay, sir, give me your haversack. So I took double the haversack and I took his skis. And I also took my skis because now we can't ski. You are now walking on the snow. And when you put one foot into the snow, over the snow, it is not hard. It is soft. And it goes at least 2 feet inside. Then you take out that foot and then you put the next foot. And then again, that goes 2 feet inside. And then like this, you are walking. And I took all this stuff. Now I'm with double stuff. Like instead of 8 kgs, now I've got 16 kgs. And 4 skis, 2 on this shoulder and plus his hand. Sir, let's start walking slowly. Let's go down. And, you know, somewhere we'll get some help. So try to come. So he and we both started walking down. But as we expected, in about 10, 15 minutes, we saw this rescue party. They had realized that something has happened to two officers. So they came and they asked what happened. And then they are the instructors. And then we said, sir, he's got injured. So they are so fit, the instructors, the Hawzar instructors are there. You know what they did? They told me, okay, you wear your ski back and you start skiing. And this officer who had his ankle fractured, they took him piggyback. They were on the skis and the man is piggyback on them and they skied down piggyback with him, carrying the weight of a person that was about 50 kgs, 50, 55 kgs. Surely we must have been at least that much, the young officers. So like within 10 minutes then I was down and he was down, he was taken to the hospital and then of course the treatment and all everything was fine. So this was something which really I remember till date, that how this rescue took place. And they appreciated me for standing by my buddy They really appreciated that. But I really could not help it because I was not that trained as those instructors who would piggyback him. Then I had my material, my weapons, then the skis and all the things within two people. It was not possible. And I had not even that well trained. I was a beginner skier. So that was something which I still remember. And of course, we stayed overnight in, we made an igloo out of snow. Igloo is a snow cave which is constructed around. And then they first taught us how to make an igloo. And then they made us stay overnight. And you know, when you are in a snow cave, inside the igloo, you are able to light, to keep ourselves warm, we could light a stove inside. It is a snow cave which we have made artificially, and yet we can light a stove inside to keep ourselves warm, and yet the snow does not break. Snow becomes like cement, right? So those are some memories of these two tough courses.
Thank you so much, sir. Your incidents are so interesting and your journey is so inspiring. So sir, my next question to you is that many films has been made about the army life. Have you seen any of them? To what extent are they based on the reality? And how did you feel about watching the war scenes?
Yeah, they do give a adrenal push, adrenal rush to you. You know, when these war scenes are depicted, they're really, really good. Right, I have seen a lot of movies. Latest one, Sher Shah, was a good movie. I really appreciate the realistic shootings. Because though I have not been in Kargil, but I have been equal altitude in Uri sector and in other sectors in the north. So I can imagine what so difficult it is to... actual operations, of course, are so difficult. And I think filming them realistically, the way these people do, are also very difficult. So they've done it well. I've seen that Ghazi movie, I've seen Sher Shah, I've seen Uri, and I've also been inspired by a movie called K-19, which is on a leadership movie, right? So they are good, but of course the real scenes are much more difficult. And when you are in actual operations, which if I can recount, it is no way what the movie can project. But still, whatever they project for the common man to understand, they have to do the way they do, little whatever modifications they do. But it is still inspiring for a call. And I think more movies should be made so that, you know, people get inspired for love of the nation.
So true, sir. Army life is too inspiring. Thank you, sir. Sir, my next question. In your opinion, what should a new candidate have? And how can they prepare themselves for the army career?
You see, army picks up their candidates from the society, right? It is from nowhere else. We are part of the society and we come back to the society. Okay, so we are just a cross section of what the society is. Only thing, they put us into physical and mental hardship training, and that really, really makes us what do you call a man or whatever. Tough today, so even women, men are equally into it and they are doing the training so well. I have got so many students were motivated to join, and so many have even passed out and become young officers and lady officers, both of them, right? So I always tell that armed forces require, broadly if I tell you in a layman's language, four broad things as an officer, as a leader. Now when we call as an officer, who's an officer? Officer is basically a leader of men, right? So he's a leader. Initially, he'll have small teams which he has to lead. As he grows in service, in rank, he has larger teams to lead. Right. So he's a leader at every stage. So when I have to pick up a military leader, four things are very important. And the first among the four is he should be intelligent. Second is he should have a friendly, adjustable nature. Because as armed forces, you will be put into a lot of teamwork. The whole armed force of armed work, armed forces work, whether it is army or navy or air force, it is all teamwork. You seldom operate singly or in small numbers. You will always work together. So first is intelligence, second is friendly and adjustable nature, third is your confidence in yourself, and fourth is courage. So friendly, intelligent, friendly, confident and courageous. young men and women is what we are looking at. And we have number of tests in which we will check what you call as officer-like qualities. But they are basically divided into these four broad things, if I you know, put it in a nutshell for a common man to understand. Right.
Thank you, sir. It will be really helpful to the students who want to enter into army career.
Yeah.
So, sir, what was the most proud moment of your life? One that you have felt Bharat Mata ke liye kuch bhi. It has been ever happened to you?
Yeah, I think once I rejoined, I'm from an army family, and you know, my father, the most inspiring moment, if I tell you, is what you see, the national flag here. My father died in service and I was in my college, right? And his body was wrapped in this national flag. I've seen my father when I came for the funeral from Bombay. I seen my father wrapped in the national flag. Okay. And it is such an honor to be wrapped in the national flag. And I thought, if ever I die, this is the highest honor the country will give you, to wrap you in the national flag. Now, once the day my father died, my interview, SSB, they call it, SSB, was about a week away. And I came back from Bombay to attend his funeral, right? And after 5 days was my reporting. Under any normal circumstances, it would be very difficult for a person to go. But my mother, in spite of such a difficult situation, she said that her father wanted you to be an army officer. You go. So, Sarali, I can share with you, on 17th March 1988, I did his funeral. On 18th March, we picked up the remains. And on 19th March 1988, I was sitting in the train going for my SSB. So after 7 days of the journey, I was selected, and then there was no looking back. Right. So at the end of the mind, what was it? What is the flag? It is our Bharat Mata, right? And if we can serve our country in whatever capacity, I think that is the ultimate aim of this life. Now, it's not that only army people are serving the country. So many other professions are also serving the nation. But I came on this line, I choose this line, and I enjoyed every bit of it.
Thank you so much, sir. I'm sure your father would be so proud of you. So, sir, now I would like to request Tanusha to continue this session. I request audience member and participants to leave their questions in the comment section or on the WhatsApp group. We will take them all after the session.
Thank you, Sonali. Jai Hind, sir.
Jai Hind.
Sir, do you belong to an army family, or do you want to serve the Mother Earth with your passion?
I think it is both. I belong to the army family, and the army family brought in the passion, right? Because all the time you are, you know, seeing people in uniform singing the national anthem or the function. As a child, I remember, you know, going into attending the official functions of my father's battalion, and all that, you know, national fervor is there, the national flavor is there everywhere. So that what's actually motivated me. That was like my kind of a goal number one, to join the armed forces. Yeah. So
thank
both
you,
the
sir.
Things.
Yeah. So I think one has to be mentally as
and
well as
one more
physically.
Thing, I would also give you one more thing as far as the life in armed forces concerned. So I was with my father, and you know, the best part is that in armed forces, you belong to various regions of the country, various castes, creeds, religions. There is no difference. I have myself been to a temple, to a YC with my father. We would go to the unit temple. We celebrate Janmashtami, we'll celebrate all religions, we'll sing the Aarti, and on Baisakhi, everybody comes to the Gurdwara, right? So it's like there's no separation of religions and things. There's no talk on that. Everybody participates in every event. Comes Christmas, everybody's celebrating. Comes Eid, everybody's celebrating those festivals together. Holi, we'll have the Holi Puja. And when I was commissioned in the Maha Regiment. And Maha Regiment, being a pure battalion of Maha Regiment, where I was commissioned were Buddhist troops, right? So when I joined the battalion, they told me, "Oh, our troops are Buddhists." And I said, "Yes, sir. I know the battalion history. I've read it." So he says, "So Sunday is going to be the temple. There's a parade, Mandir parade. So everybody has to go, and you have to sing the Buddhist hymns. So please remember them." So before Sunday, on Friday, somebody came to me. He brought me those, scriptures of Buddha, which they narrate. Now in Hindu temple, you have aarti. In Buddhist temple, you have something called a Trisharan Panchsheet, and the Buddham Sharanam Gacchami and all that japs are there. So I memorize that so that when I'm sitting with my troops, they should not feel that this officer doesn't know our prayers and his lips are closed. So you should be also in the chorus. You also got to sing with it. So that was the kind of environment we live in, and I wish and pray that everybody of our country, gets that kind of harmony, what we have seen in our armed forces. So that is my kind of message that to everyone, that this is the life we have lived. This is the kind of respect we had. And there's only one goal for the country. You are asking me, for the motherland. That comes first. This flag comes first, what you see here, every time. And nothing else comes first. Right? I was posted in an operational area. So there was a small ritual when you used to go for operational patrols, right? So the troops have a, we are all very religious people. All Indians are very religious, whatever religion they believe in. So they will do a small prayer together when they're going on an operational patrol. Because you're going to, sometimes you get encounters and face bullets and all, You've seen death in operations very closely, even I've seen very closely. So we were replacing a Sikh unit. So there are Sikh regiment. So I'm from Maha Regiment. The Maha Regiment has got troops of Maharashtra, and they were that mostly Buddhist. So we were replacing a Sikh unit in the JNK high altitude sector. And as per the ritual, they would say small when they used to go for patrolling, we were going along with them, learning the routes and all. So they would do a small they'll do a small prayer, that is a Sikh prayer, and then they will go launch themselves and do their bole sonyal and all that. So when I was to stand behind them because we were in that learning stage with them, and our troops also would do. So I would participate in the Buddhist prayers with my patrol as a patrol leader, singing the Buddhist hymns, and then going on the patrol. Right. So this is the kind of cultures we are used to when we serve in the armed forces. Right. So I think that's something which every one of us must be full in our heart, right? Let's move ahead.
Correct. So India is a secular country, and if everyone will have the opinion like you, then we will not face any communal rights in our country. So thank you so
I
much,
have
sir.
done I have presided over havans. When you are the senior most in the battalion, you have to do the havan. So I have presided over that. And you talk of whatever ceremony is, we all participate in that, like that. Okay, let's move ahead.
So I think one has to be mentally as well as physically strong to become a good colonel. So how does one go with about acquiring that, sir?
Nothing like a like everybody, all soldiers, whether it's a colonel or a major or a general, or a soldier, right? Everyone has to be mentally and physically strong. At times, even the soldiers, they have to be so strong that they have participated well. So whether you are whatever rank you are, you have more responsibilities, right? And you discharge your responsibilities as per your whatever is expected from you. So as far as physical fitness is concerned, it is part of a daily routine of every soldier, whether he's a jawan or the JCO or an officer, right? So that becomes part of it, and it is so much part of it that even after retirement, at times we can't sleep late because the habit has come. The body wakes you up at 6 a.m. and tells you, okay, go for some physical fitness. Why are you sleeping on the bed? Right. So that becomes part and parcel of your life. So, you know, I remember going on a mission with about, there was the only officer and there were six Jawans with me. And, you know, we were climbing, we are supposed to open a new route to a mountain peak, which is around 14,600 feet. So near the last point, near the about 1,000 feet below that, we were exhausted because we were climbing and it was daytime. And on the other side, we could see the Pakistanis about 1 kilometer distance away. On that was Pakistan. I was posted on LC. And because it was, the climb was so steep, we were exhausted and we had, you know, water also finished. Now, we are all thirsty. So the Jawan asked me, sir, water is finished. We all carrying 1 liter of water from 3,000 feet below because we knew that on this higher reaches, there's no spring or no water jharna where you could fill fresh water to drink. Now the water is finished. So then what we did, we tried to look around, what do we do? And everybody, because you are almost dehydrated, because you are sweating and the temperature also low, but it was sheer sunshine and we are sweating. And because you are sweating, you are dehydrated. After climbing 500, 600 feet, 1,000 feet, you need water and everybody has consumed water. So I looked at, I was about 24 years old, a young boy, a lieutenant, and then there were 2-3 soldiers. I said, let's go. I found a snow patch which has not melted when, you know, in a corner. Otherwise, snow had melted during the peak summer. So I said, let's get that snow. So it was about a patch of soft snow. So we got hold of that patch and we filled that soft snow into our water bottles, right? And then we also heated and made a cup of tea. And we all had it and we, you know, melted the snow and it became water. 1/3. If the snow was this much, it gave us about 1.5 to 2 bottles of water. So then we had that water. We got some energy and we did the last leap of 500 feet and then we reached the top. So everyone has to be mentally tough, right? Dehydrated, but yet we said we have to move up. So find out a way, right? So the way was dig the snow, melt it, drink and hydrate yourself and move and complete your mission. So that is the kind of things. And everybody has to be fit. Jawans are also fit. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir. Your journey is worth listening and in spreading. So having written self-help books, we want to know that how one can achieve success in life after enduring the battles.
See, I believe in one thing, and most of his self-help books are based on teamwork. I believe that teamwork is the essence of any victory. Though we do talk of individual excellences, individual valor, individual sacrifices, but at the end of it, see, even behind an individual victory or individual, you know, there is a team which is supporting that individual. And in armed forces, it is all team effort. When we launch operations, when we capture, you know, features, famous features, Tiger Lion and all that, the whole battalion, the company, the platoons are involved in it. Yes, there are numerous examples of personal valor who have got exemplary dedication to duty. But that is part of one teamwork. So I, even in my self-help books, I always project that teamwork, whether it is in armed forces or in any other, today even corporate world has started believing in teamwork, right? So that is a sense of any victory in any field. So that has been my the mantra all the time. And second mantra has been converting your failures to success. Do not believe that you will not get any hurdles in your life. It is how you tackle hurdles comes your path of victory. I've authored a book, I can even show you, it is there with me right now, on teamwork, and I've authored a book on management of failures. See, this is a book on teamwork called Teams of Tomorrow. Now, what is going to be Teams of Tomorrow? It's going to be a lot of teamwork, including virtual teams, right? And this book is How Do You Manage Failures? How Do You Manage Setbacks? It's called Can You Stop the Gushing Stream? This is a gushing stream, you cannot stop. You stop it, it will change the way and it will move down where it wants to be. So two things are essence is never get dejected completely by our failures. Always think, what was the reason? And the moment you identify the reason, it is a sure shot path to success in your next attempt. That is my first assessment. I in my complete career, I have had not less setbacks. I have had my share of setbacks, which everyone has, but I always fought back. That's one. And second one is teamwork. And these both are very essential in any field you work. That is my mantra to everyone. Have lots of friends, right? Project yourself, work with teams. If you are a team leader, always motivate your teams. Have synergy, put synergy into them, and you will achieve success. Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir. We will definitely want to read the books and get inspiration and some motivation from your books and apply them in our lives. Sir, can you describe a funny prank that you and your friends played on each other while you were deployed? And what fun things did you and your friends do together at that time?
We did not do any pranks like that because we are not in that age where you do pranks. But there was some, describe very emotional scene, which was a non-kind of operational. So one of my seniors, he was newly married and I was posted in Udi. And now he was at a post which was totally snowbound and it was cut off for almost 6 months. It would stay cut off, and the only logistic support was through a helicopter. It will go there, drop the food, and drop their letters and all which has come. So I was at the base, and my the senior officer, he was at that post, and helicopter would come once in 15 days. And we load it with fresh vegetables and all the requirements. And most awaited used to be the letters from their families, right? And then the helicopter would take off from Udi base and it'll fly about 15 minutes and it'll hover over the post. It could not even land at some time when the snow was too much, and just drop those packages, and then they'll pick it up, and then they'll, you know. And we were in touch with walkie-talkies, what you call it, radio sets. That's called walkie-talkies. So we had this radio set. So my senior was newly married. Now, obviously, when you're newly married, he was expecting letters. In our time, there's no emails and no WhatsApp. It was only physical letters. So he would keep asking me every evening, NPR letter, I have quiz. So I was at the base, so I would get the dark and check, sir, aaj nahi aaya. Oh, chalo, theek hai. Now the wait starts for tomorrow's convoy letter coming. Now he's sitting on a snowbound post and I am at the base. So let's say after 3-4 days, the letter, sir, aaj letter aa gaya. So once he was expecting some big news in his letter, or he must have written something to his wife and he was expecting a reply. So he said, yaar, when is the next flight coming? I said, sir, abhi 2-3 pehle to gayi hai flight, abhi agli to aayegi hafta. Kehte yaar, thoda usko ring wang kar, thoda jaldi aa jayega. Maine kaha, sir, kuch bhi karo, hafte se pehle to nahi aayega. Right? He said, oh yaar, fir kaise kare? So I said, sir, wait karo. कहता नहीं यार वेट नहीं होगा. आई वॉन्ट टू नो सर वट शी हैज रिटन. सो ही टोल्ड मी, यू स्टडीड इन बॉम्बे ना, यू मस्ट बी नोइंग मराठी. शी हैज रिटन इन मराठी, राइट? सो आई सेड, यार सर, आई नो हाउ टू रीड मराठी, बट आई कैन इवन अंडरस्टैंड अ लिटिल बिट. ही सेज, यू कैन अंडरस्टैंड फुल? आई सेड, नो नो, नॉट एट ऑल. आई कांट अंडरस्टैंड मराठी फुल, बट आई कैन रीड, बिकॉज यू नो, बीइंग इन बॉम्बे, आई वुड रीड द यू नो बस पे क्या लिखा है एंड ऑल दैट. एंड मराठी इज सिमिलर टू हिंदी language little bit, the script. So he said, yaar, fir tu chitti khol ke padh dena mere ko. I said, sir, kya baat kar rahe ho? Well, how can I read your newly married, whatever ma'am must have written in your letter? He said, tere ko samajh to aayegi nahi. Maine kaha, haan sir, nahi aayegi, but still, kehta tu padh de. So imagine, I read his letter, I opened his letter, and on the radio set, I read it out in whatever Marathi I could, and I read it quite well, and he understood at the end of it. He said, what did you understand? I said, nothing, sir. Right? Though I understood a little bit, 1-2 sentences. I said, sir, what did you understand? He said, I've understood everything what I wanted to understand. So that was an emotional scene. And we enjoyed that bit. And you know, we remembered this. And when I met ma'am after coming down from Udi after, I think, about 1 year. And I told ma'am, you know, I've read your letter. She said, how did you read my letter? I said, I had no choice. Your husband requested me to read it. So I read it. But don't worry, I didn't understand anything out of it. So then she was, okay, then it is fine. If you've not understood, then it is okay. Right. So these are some interesting things you remember from your army lives. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir, for sharing such a important incident of your training period. So what message do you want to convey to our young people? How should they serve the country and the society?
See, I will tell this message. If you are fit physically and mentally, do take this as a career. Do take this as a career. Now, why I'm saying it's not applicable to all, because army requires a little bit of physical fitness, which is the mandatory ones, medical things, physical things. They have their own measurements and their own essential things. If you are fitting into it, please take this plunge and serve in the defense forces. You will not repent. The kind of life you will get, you cannot dream of such a life outside. You can't even dream of such a life outside, because now I'm out. And I share you one very good example. You live in cantonments. The cantonment life is so different. Now I have taken retirement when I come, because I was born in a cantonment until 50 years. Till the time I took retirement, I was living in cantonments. So during my life, I had only one visit abroad, and I went to Washington in 2010. So when I was roaming on this road, I used to just walk in Washington, right? Keep walking and seeing the town. And because that was the only town and I had to stay there for 1 month, I found it very neat and clean everywhere. So one day I decided, I was walking in a suburb, that let me see on the roadside when I'm walking, do I find a piece of, you know, some dirt or something thrown around? So there was none. I walked for 1 kilometer, there was none. So when I came back into my cantonment, and one day I said, let me see if I can find one dirty thing being thrown on the side, some peel or anything, there was none. So somebody asked me, how did Washington look like? I said, look like our cantonment. That is the environment you are getting as part of an army officer, right? So what more are you wanting in life? It is giving you adventure. It is giving you, you know, time to study. I joined after my final year graduate. And today you can see I have prefixed PhD. This is, I've done within my service. I did my MSc, I did my PhD. They are giving you opportunity to enhance your skills if you want to study. They are giving you to go for adventures, extreme adventures, play sports, so many Olympics medals, right? So they're offering you everything and anything what you're looking for. So my message to the youth is, put in efforts. Where I find the youth lacking today, why they're not able to join, why the pass percentage is less, there is the academies are not getting filled with the vacancies, and I find the reason is the youth, though some of them do dream, they are not preparing well. They are not putting in adequate efforts. The efforts have to be in right direction. I get so many calls on Instagram and, you know, the small things. When I say to them, put in effort, understand what is the syllabus, what are they looking at. But very few of them do it seriously. So my message to the youth is, do take it as a career choice. It's a fantastic career choice, but then don't take it lightly. Prepare for it and you will get selected. I think the maximum vacancies, if any job is offering today, is armed forces. Right. So subscribe to that, prepare yourself well and go and face. They are looking for confident young men and women who are physically fit and who are intelligent, who are friendly. So that's not so difficult, isn't it? Only thing, the will has to be there to put in effort. No job comes in without effort, right? So have the will, put in effort, you will get through. Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir, for inspiring our youth. I hope they will understand and learn something from your talk. So my last question to you is, what do you intend to contribute to the aims of Swachhta Jagran Samiti, that is cleaning and awakening of the nation?
See, nation is already awake to whatever issues we are having. And Swachhta Jagran Samiti, and I'm very happy at their objectives when I saw it. They are working towards these things. And one such example I just gave you about terms of cleanliness. I think each and every person of ours, right? We have to adopt it as part of our lives. And I felt very happy one day when I was traveling in a car and I was, you know, we were reading something, and the general habit is, you know, lower the window and throw it out. And my children told, don't throw it out. Keep it inside. Once we reach our destination, we'll throw it in the dustbin. That is the kind of mentality each one of us, wherever we stay, the area around us and all. And these kind of NGOs, the NGOs like the Swachhta Jagran Samiti, can do a lot. And they are doing a lot towards awakening of the people and making our own country a place where we would love to stay. Right? Make your own home. The country is our home. Make our own home so attractive that we enjoy every bit and every moment of it. My kudos to this organization who are taking such steps and doing a lot at the society level, and I'm sure your efforts will pay dividends in the coming time.
Thank you so much, sir. Well, that's all from me. Are there questions any from the audience? Can you please take the questions from the audience, please, Sonali?
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Tanusha. So, sir, the question from audience is, like, first question is from Rishabh Mahajan. Jai Hind, sir. So, which regiment belonged to your father?
My father was an AC officer, Army Service Corps. And he died in service. He had met with an accident, and during that accident, he died.
Okay, thank you, sir. So the next question is, what is your success mantra?
Yeah. I couldn't get it. There was some disturbance. I couldn't get what success. I can't read.
So the question is, what is your success mantra?
My success mantra is simple. Teamwork and teamwork. That's it. And that is all which will fetch you anywhere you want to go. Okay. So whenever you have, whenever you're going into some work, have teamwork. That is the success mantra.
Thank you, sir, for sharing your mantra. So the next question from the audience is that we are also seeing women and entering the armed forces. So what advice would you like to give to the women?
Very nice. This latest decision, the Supreme Court has, the women are already there from 1992 onwards. They are serving very well with total success. And now the Supreme Court permitting into the ND also, hopefully the government will accept that and they'll open the doors. So they'll come into permanent commission and all. So women are doing a splendid job in all fields, and now Army, Navy, Air Force, they have come in. And I look at them as equal to male officers doing all the same kind of work in the coming times, right? So I've got a lot of the students who are girls, and I see a lot of potential in them. So I think they're not going to break all the ceilings, which so far has not been done. So we look forward to, you know, women officers who are coming in. And I also feel that there is a time that we could even open the doors for women soldiers. Right? Not everybody can come into as officers. So we are 1.3 million armed forces. We have already made a small beginning by taking them into the military police. We can, you know, expand that and take them into the other verticals of the armed forces also, yeah, as soldiers also.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
So the other question is, how was your feeling when you joined Army first time?
How was your feeling?
Yes.
So, the feeling when you join is, when you clear the final exam and when you find yourself in the merit list, that is the best moment, right? You are the top of the world, you are in cloud 9, right? You feel, I have achieved a great feat. Yeah, when you go for training, initial days are tough. Lot of people feel, oh, it's physically too grueling. But yes, one has to go through it. When you join the training, a lot of pains here and there, you are running and doing so many things. and you know the body starts paining, but then you carry on with it, and within 1 month you get attuned to it and body adjusts, and then it's not that tough at all. So it's a great achievement, it's a great feeling.
Thank you so much, sir. It was good to hear and learning from your efforts as deeply.
So, our Swachhta Jagran Samiti team salutes you. We all wish you continued success. Having you here and learning from you is a blessing.
Thank you very much. And thank you so much. I would really convey my best wishes to Swachhta Jagran Samiti. And thank you so much for inviting me, giving me this opportunity to talk to this the young generation of our country. And if my words have been of even little motivation to them and they serve the armed forces, I think I would have achieved my aim of sparing this time for you. Once again, Jai Hind, Jai Bharat. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Jai Hind. Thank you, audience, for your time and joining this session. And I hope you all are taking something useful away from it. So we are now ending this session with due permission of you all. If you still have any questions, you can WhatsApp or mail us. We'll take them into consideration. Stay in touch. We will update you with our next session. Thank you.